Well, good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to Park Road Presbyterian Church. So good to be with you today as we gather, believe it or not, on November 1st of 2020. I hope you had an enjoyable evening last night. Typically, we would have been here for our fall festival, but a different year, and then it poured all night and all afternoon. So small mercies, maybe. But we're delighted to gather to worship this morning. And just a few announcements as we get started. If you would like to follow along with the liturgy, you can find that on our website. It'll also be projected on the screen behind me. In lieu of not having our fall festival last night, we are this coming Friday, with hopefully wonderful weather, going to have a more small, kind of intimate, kind of in-house, what we're calling fall family night from 5:30 to 8 p.m. It's going to be all outdoors. I'm going to be showing Charlie Brown's Great Pumpkin for the kids, and just have some simple games for the adults, hot dogs, popcorn, just kind of a fun time to be together and celebrate the season. Exactly. And fellowship together. And so we hope you'll come. You can register for that. Bring a chair, bring a dish to share, just a kind of simple, fun evening for us to be together this Friday on November 6th at 5:30. Also, 2 weeks from today, we are planning to resume our Sunday school for both adults and children. So we're going to have two classes for the adults that will be meeting upstairs as we complete the renovation up there, and then two classes we're going to be offering for children, nursery, and then our K through 5. We're in the plans of how we're doing all that, and if you're interested in helping us volunteer for those spots, please come talk to me. We'll be in touch with how we're going to be doing things with protocols and our curriculums and all that. So November 15th, 2 weeks from today, for 6 weeks as we finish out the year, concluding on December 20th. And then finally today, as you see before us, we are going to be celebrating communion. And as we did last month for the first time, we're going to be doing it a little bit differently. All of the elements are contained in little individual cups with lids. There'll be an elder behind each table to serve you. And when it comes time, an usher will dismiss you out to the outer aisles, and you'll come back around and you can pick up the elements, and then you can hold them, and we'll take them together with one another at the appropriate time when everyone's been served. Okay, so we look forward to celebrating in that family meal today to really remember what has been done for us in Christ. So with all that said, would you turn your attention to the screen, or if you're looking at page 1 in the bulletin, as we come to our call to worship, which comes from Isaiah chapter 55. Is anyone thirsty? Come and drink. Even if you have no money, come, take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Why spend your money on food that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you will eat what is good. You will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, and you will find life. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the unfailing love I promised to David. Would you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we come now to worship you, the one who has made everlasting covenant with us, who has shown us your unfailing love in sending Jesus to us. Lord, we come to celebrate this morning, to sing, to praise you. And so as we do, would you, through your Spirit, help us to see you more clearly, help us to be filled with the joy of your Spirit. And as we look forward to celebrating this family meal today, God, would you remind us of your presence with us? Would you grant us your grace to continue day by day following you? We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to rise and sing with us today.
Proclaim and come.
to turn your attention to the screen or to the top of page 6 as we respond to the voice of God this morning to hear these words of Jesus. Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son does remain forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." Our Father, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, in what we have done and in what we have failed to do. Lord Jesus Christ, you came to liberate us from guilt, sin, and death, and to share your sonship with us. Help us walk in the freedom you purchased. We pray for people you have brought into our lives. Lord, draw them to yourself and glorify your mercy in them. And now we pray as the Son of God taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Now we come to declare our faith, the opportunity for us as Christians to state what it is that we believe. And so I'll invite you to rise as we declare our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed this morning. And so I will ask you, Christian, what is it that you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Amen. my strong salvation. God is 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 my strong salvation. What foe have I to fear? What foe have I to fear? God is my strong salvation. God is my strong salvation. What foe have I to fear? What foe have I to fear? God is my strong salvation. God is my strong salvation. What foe have I to fear? What foe have I to fear? God is my strong salvation. God is my strong salvation. What foe have I to fear? What foe have I to Place on the Lord reliance, my soul with courage wait. God's truth be thine affiance, when faith and desolate. God's might thy heart shall strengthen. Joy increase, mercy thy day shall lengthen. The Lord will give thee peace.
If you're following in the bulletin, would you please turn to page 10? If you're following on the screen, you'll see that, God willing, right behind me in a moment. Let me pray for us, and then I'm going to read the first part of 1 Samuel chapter 13. Let's pray together. We're grateful, Lord, for all that you're doing in the world today to stir up the world that people might think about life and mortality and judgment. We ask that the Holy Spirit would hover over us as he hovered over the waters at the start, and Holy Spirit, that you would bring order into the chaos of our thinking and the chaos of our hearts and desires, and that you would set us free. Lord, that you would cultivate our souls and make them to be, like the prophets said, a watered garden. And now, Lord, bless the reading of your word, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be ever pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verses 1 through 15. Saul was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 42 years over Israel. Now Saul chose for himself 3,000 men of Israel, of which 2,000 were with Saul in Michmash and in the hill country of Bethel, while 1,000 were with Jonathan at Gibeah of Benjamin. But he sent away the rest of the people, each to his tent. Jonathan smote the garrison of the Philistines that was at Geba, and the Philistines heard of it. Then Saul blew the trumpet throughout the land, saying, "Let the Hebrews hear." All Israel heard the news that Saul had smitten the garrison of the Philistines, and also that Israel had become odious to the Philistines. The people were then summoned to Saul at Gilgal. Now the Philistines assembled to fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, and people like the sand which is on the seashore in abundance. And they came up and camped at Michmash, east of Bel-Avon. When the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, for the people were hard-pressed, Then the people hid themselves in caves, in thickets, in cliffs, in cellars, and in pits. Also, some of the Hebrews crossed the Jordan into the land of Gad and Gilead. But as for Saul, he was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. Now he waited 7 days according to the appointed time set by Samuel, but Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattering from him. So Saul said, "Bring to me the burnt offering and the peace offerings." And he offered the burnt offering. As soon as he finished offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him and to greet him. But Samuel said, "What have you done?" And Saul said, "Because I saw that the people were scattering from me, and that you did not come within the appointed days, and the Philistines were assembling at Michmash, therefore I said, 'Now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not asked the favor of the Lord.' So I forced myself and offered the burnt offering." Samuel said to Saul, "You have acted foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever, but now your kingdom shall not endure. The Lord has sought out for himself a man after his own heart, and the Lord appointed him as ruler over his people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you." Then Samuel set out and went up from Gilgal to Gibeah of Benjamin, and Saul counted the people who were present with him, about 600 men. The word of the Lord. A few years ago, I read an article. It's a short, humorous, and I think wise article. I've returned to it several times since the first reading. And in the article, the authors take apart some of the phrases and sayings and colloquialisms that have entered in, kind of weaseled into our corporate vocabulary at this moment in our cultural history. Some of the adages that they picked apart and showed what they really mean. One of them was, "It's all good." And we say that now. It's all good. And then they analyzed it and they said what people really mean when they use that saying, "It's all good." Quote, "It's not all good. Something has gone badly amiss, and I absolutely don't want to admit it. It's all good." Another phrase, "Just saying." Just saying. And then what it really means. "Don't even think I want to convince you of something. Believe me, all truth is relative, except my own opinions. Just saying. It is what it is." They analyze that. "You think?" They analyze that. "How great is that?" They looked at that. "No worries." Yada, yada, yada. What do people really mean when they say these things? Great article dissecting these 10 phrases. If you want the article, reach out to me. I'll send it to you. One expression, however, I did not find in that top 10 list was one that I myself have often used, and I would venture to say you also have used it, and that is, "Hey, what can you do?" It's like a handy saying conveying acceptance and resignation to things that you have realized you just are powerless to change. What can you do? Someone flushed a diaper down our toilet. I had to call the plumber. What can you do? So much rain lately. Hey, what can you do? Who'll stop the rain? Can't. And so my question to us today, as we look at this sad episode from ancient Israel, my question is, what can you do? You want to change the world? You want to earn a little bit more money to make your life easier? You want to get your kids in line? You want to get your husband in line? You have big goals. You have little goals. You have huge aspirations. Or you just want to get by. You just want to survive. What can you do? And what can you do spiritually to enhance or improve your walk or your relationship with God? Hey, what can you do? And you may be surprised at the answer that arises out of this passage where God is teaching his church and using this mysterious figure, Saul, who went on into a life of insanity and paranoid, seething bitterness. Saul, the first human king of Israel, God used this tragic man and this particular sad story to teach us, hey, what can you do? Today I want to look at Saul's rising tide of troubles, what he did in response to that rising tide, and lastly, how to avoid making the same mistake. Again, Saul's rising tide of troubles, what he did in response to that tide, and lastly, how you can avoid doing the same thing. Last 2 weeks together here looking at the life of Saul have been so pleasant because everything just seems to be so promising for Israel, for Saul, for Samuel, that is, the prophet priest, and for tall Saul. Israel gets the big handsome king that they're looking for, a king like all the other nations. Saul goes from chasing donkeys one day to sitting at a huge feast the other day at the seat of honor and all Israel saying, "Hail, long live the king." Samuel, as the outgoing administration, the prophet priest, as his last official act, he calls Israel together, he presents them with their sin, and the reader thinks maybe he's going to meet with a lot of excuses and a lot of blame shifting. Nope. Instead, he meets with humility as the people repent, and he responds to them with the repetition of good news where he says, God will not reject you, and I will not stop praying for you. It's like a seamless transfer of power, which, by the way, was very rare in the ancient Middle East. And then apparently a lot of time elapses. We don't know exactly how long, but all of a sudden Saul shows up again. This time he has an adult son, so adult that he can lead 1,000 troops. So he must be a little further advanced in his own age. And Jonathan, his son, carries out this special ops raid on the Philistines. And by the way, where it says the Philistine garrison, actually the word is the Philistine prefect. Looks like they carried out an assassination on a military leader of the Philistines. And after they carried out that special ops mission, it stirs up the hornet's nest. And the Philistines are like murder hornets that we've all been reading about. And Saul is evidently proud of his military son. He blows the trumpet, the ram's horn, and he says, "Look, my son conquered our enemy in my name. You can tell we're going to have a real working relationship. I see a dynasty in the making." And then the Philistines, the murder hornets stirred up as they are, they strike back and they bring the heat. They bring 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen. They had iron weapons and iron chariots, something that the Israelites had not yet mastered. This is the dawn of the Iron Age, but the Israelites are a little slow on the technology side. And they look out on the Philistines, and the Philistines are described in a way that Israel was once described to Abraham. They are as numerous as the sand of the seashore, too many to even count. And Israel was afraid, understandably. The people, it says, hide in caves and in bushes and in basements. And then some begin to even run away. In fact, they gathered at Gilgal. And if you really know your Bible well, you may remember some of the things that happened at Gilgal, one of which, perhaps the most famous thing at Gilgal, was after the Israelites crossed the Jordan River, God held back the waters, Then Joshua the general told the priests, go back into the riverbed and take out 12 boulders, one for each tribe, and set it up where? At Gilgal, like an everlasting monument to the goodness of God and the grace of God that he did for them what they could not do themselves, namely hold back the water. And some of the, quote, Hebrews, which is kind of a loaded word that's used, I think, twice in this passage, Hebrews is kind of a loaded word hearkening back to their time in Egypt when they were called those Hebrews. And some of the Hebrews escaped back to the other side of the Jordan. It's like a reversal of everything Joshua did. It's like a repudiation of the conquest of the land as they go back to the other side of the Jordan. It's like Joshua never even mattered. It's really bad. Saul is standing his ground. He's staying at that very special place where those boulders were, packed with history, history of God's grace and help to his people, where God parted the river. Maybe Saul's looking at that, those stones, and they're reminding him God can be trusted. And King Saul is waiting for the prophet priest Samuel to arrive. They've apparently made some sort of arrangement. And Saul knows that he cannot go into battle without instructions from the prophet. The priest Samuel has to offer the sacrifices, and the prophet Samuel has to give him instructions for the battle. He's waiting for the word that comes out of the mouth of the prophet, and he's waiting, and he's waiting, and he's waiting, and the whole 7 days goes by, and still Samuel hasn't arrived as they agreed upon. And now with the seventh day, apparently, almost done, all the people scattering from him, he's watching his army go that way, the enemy coming from that this way, advancing with all their heavy metal, chariots and implements of war made of iron. And he's watching his own army melting like ice in the Florida sun. Numbers are dwindling. Looks a lot like Gideon, by the way. Remember in Gideon, all the people hid in these exact same places, in basements and thickets and bushes. Special ops operation where Gideon tore down one of their altars and the Midianites retaliated like a hornet's nest. People hiding, Gideon hiding, like we saw Saul hiding in the last chapter. Numbers fading. Gideon's army goes from 22,000 down to 10,000, down to 300. You remember that? And now King Saul knows he has to have God on his side. He's hopelessly outnumbered, but Samuel the prophet and priest is nowhere to be found. And Saul has to be thinking, hey, what can you do? So against his better judgment, says I forced myself. He says, bring me the burnt offerings and the peace offerings. These are desperate times. You know what they say, right? Desperate times call for desperate measures. And he himself, in lieu of the prophet priest, offers the sacrifices in order to ensure that God is happy with them and that God will go into battle against this impossibly huge and technologically superior army. And just then, wouldn't you know it, just then, up comes Samuel, and he says, Adam, what have you done? Sounds like that, doesn't it? What have you done? Very much like the first instance of human sin in the Garden of Eden. Saul, we've already seen, is like a second Adam. He did what Adam failed to do. He crushed the serpent's head, Nahash, remember? And here he looks a lot more like the old Adam. What have you done? Who told you you were naked? And just like the first Adam and the first sin, Saul offers a readily available series of valid proofs and reasons for why he did what he did and why it's not really his fault. The people are running away. They're actually reversing the conquest of Joshua. You didn't come when you said you were going to come. It's like the woman that you gave me, remember? And I had to have God's special presence, and you see how big the Philistine army is. Look at it. I'm sure you can see it yourself. So I did what I had to do. You know, what can you do? And Samuel responds, not this. You, he says, have acted foolishly and not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, and now your reign is over. It will not last. There will be no dynasty. Now, you may be thinking at this point, I'm not exactly sure what was so wrong about what Saul did or didn't do. You remember Moses? Remember that one time where Moses had a lapse in his faith and he struck the rock twice? And you think, really? For that little thing, he brought the people all the way up to the promised land, but he was excluded himself from entering. You scratch your head. I'm not sure that the time fit the crime. And he did offer excuses, but as I look at the excuses, don't they all seem pretty valid? I mean, it's true that the Philistine army was so big. It's true that someone had to ask for God's help. It's true that if he just looked, Samuel would see all the Israelite army is leaving. All you have to do is look at it. What can you do? You know, I was in another country. I won't tell you the country, but we were in another nation, and I was with a group, and one of the guys that was with us jumped over a ditch. It was a ditch that we were digging, and he slipped on the other side of the ditch and caught himself, and it dislocated his shoulder. And it's very painful, I've heard. I haven't experienced it. But so we had to find a doctor, but we were in a small village, and the only doctor we could find was a gynecologist. But you know, what can you do? You just have to do the best with what you have. You have to make do. So this gynecologist set his shoulder, and he also threw in a free pelvic exam. No, just that's sorry. But you know, you make it work. What can you do? You manage, you improvise. Desperate times. And seriously, as you read this passage, don't you feel a little sorry for Saul? It seems like for that one infraction, under the most dire of circumstances, seeing with his own eyes the onslaught of the murder hornets stirred up, that lives would be lost on the Israelite side. It says, look, the people are fleeing. They're reversing everything that Joshua accomplished. Do you feel a little bad for Saul? And do you think maybe Samuel kind of has it in for him that the prophet overreacted? Do you feel that way? Just saying. And do you think, now I know this is church, and you who are gathered here today, you're in your nice clothes with your masks on. You'd never admit this in church, I know. Unless you're home with your little snacks and you're letting your hair down. But the people here at church would never admit maybe God was a little hard on Saul. Is it possible, maybe this once, that God could have turned it down a little bit? That God could have been in this one situation, just holy, not holy, holy, holy. And I admit, I have thought that before, and I admit, I do feel, if I really try to enter the story, I do feel a little bit sorry for Saul. I see the hopelessness of his situation, the rising tide, and I see the hopelessness of the sentence. You're out. I'm out. I just got in. For one failure, and you were late. Do I really deserve this? And you know, whenever I look at passages like this, and I feel sorry for the offender, when I feel sorry for Saul, I'm really feeling sorry for myself. Truth is, Saul sinned. And every sin deserves God's just wrath and hot displeasure. Did you hear what I said? Every sin deserves God's just wrath and hot displeasure. Even the smallest sin is cosmic treason. And God's nature is unchangeable. God, can you just turn down your holiness? No, he cannot be who he is not. He won't stop being God. And looking at Saul and his fall makes me think, wow, if God gave me what I deserved, I would be vaporized right before your very eyes. And so my question is not so much, why did Saul get what he deserved, but rather, why don't I get what I deserve? Why me, Lord? In other words, why have you blessed me? Did I go out and win my wife? When the scripture says, who finds a wife finds favor from the Lord. That everything I have and enjoy, my children, my life, my salvation before God is all an act of God's grace, and I deserve none of it. And as far as I can tell, what Saul really did in this situation was to seek a separation between the offices of prophet, priest, and king. He was king, but he was not to act outside of being in conjunction with the prophet and the priest. And I'm not so sure that the most serious sin he committed on that day was the offering of sacrifices, but rather his proceeding without relying on the word from God as spoken through the prophet. Samuel was to instruct Saul, and Saul was to be utterly, completely dependent on the word that came from the mouth of God's prophet. He was to be dependent on the word. Did you know that the kings, according to Deuteronomy, were always to carry around a book under their arm? They were to be a bookish group. It was the law that they were to write out with their own hand and always carry it around. And here he shows he's not really dependent on the word from God. It wasn't Samuel who was being rejected. Like, go on, Samuel, we don't really need you anymore. I can do this myself. It was God who was being rejected. Saul, what can you do? Well, I can only do my very best. Your best? Your best is filthy rags. It is but rubbish, said St. Paul. Saul was relying on his own eyes. He saw the tides rising. The conquest of Joshua was being reversed. The Philistines were coming. And anyone knows what you do in such a moment, you just make do. But God was saying to Saul, just making do is not going to do it. I am the one who held back the waters of the Jordan. You see those stones? They should be a reminder to you. And I am the one who gave my people the land. It wasn't Joshua. You're not reversing the work of Joshua. It was me. Saul, I am more reliable than your very eyes. It's like this tide is rising so high that the only thing above the water is Saul's lips. And he's about to go down. But God is saying, even in those circumstances, I must be trusted, and what you achieve will only be by my grace. But Saul is not a man who trusts in the good purposes of God and ready to depend on God and do what human beings simply can't do. Saul is not a man after God's own heart, and Saul never will be. Saul's not a man who lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He's not a man who lives by faith. He's a strong man. He's a tall man. He's a DIY man, do-it-yourself man. And after this tragic scene is over, and I included it, the 15th verse today, Samuel and Saul went their separate ways. Samuel went to Gibeah, and Saul, the general, the king, stays at Gilgal. And what does he do? He does a head count. Still trying to figure out if he could work it with the 600. By the way, 600 is double what Gideon had to work with. But Saul has to count them. He wants to DIY, do it yourself. When Jesus Christ came, he made this whole concept even more crystal clear when he gathers his disciples, as we saw last week in the farewell speech of Jesus, the Upper Room Discourse, and he says to them, apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing. Well, what does that mean? Are you saying that if I get a flat tire, I can't change it? Are you saying that non-Christian people can't change flat tires or take a breath or solve complicated mathematical equations? No. I'm saying that you or I or anyone else, no one can do anything to please God apart from Jesus Christ. You can't change a tire in a way that pleases God without Jesus Christ. You can't change a diaper. You can't even take your next breath in a way that pleases God apart from trusting in Jesus Christ, God's prophet, priest, and king. As prophet, he is the word of God to you, the very mind of God made flesh. He reveals God as God. You'll never see God more clearly than you see him in Jesus Christ. As priest, he offers the one and only sacrifice that can take away our record of wrongs. He stands in our place. He lives for us and dies under the weight of my guilt. As we saw last week, he prays constantly for me. His prayers hold me together. His prayers hold everything together. Again, if Jesus Christ stops praying, every molecule flies apart. And as king, he is always subduing to himself, ruling and defending us, and restraining us and our enemies and his. Saul thinks it's about Saul. He's trying to appease God, to get God to go with them in the battle, but it really is Saul working it, doing the work, trusting in his own efforts, trusting in his own eyes, not resting in the everlasting arms, and not a man resting on God's merciful heart. You want to avoid Saul's sin in your life? Trust in the person and work of Jesus Christ. He is the man after God's own heart. I love that hymn that says, "Let no other trust intrude." You know, you'll always think, man, I had five quiet times in a row this week. Banish that from your thinking as you stand before God. It is not in any way, shape, or form dependent on your quiet times, only and solely on the man after God's own heart who lived the life I should have lived and died the death I deserve to die. He is the king we need, even when your eyes don't see it, even when it appears the right thing to do it yourself. When you want to defend yourself, when you want to stand on your laurels, when you want to tell yourself that you're not that bad. Instead, the way of Jesus is his grace that we rest on and we receive. We constantly face our undeserving and his outrageous generosity, and we rest on that and we wait. Look, I admit, it's a hard passage. And I admit that this way of explaining it is counterintuitive in the extreme. that I can do nothing to fix the world, nothing to save this floundering nation. Come on, I can't even take my next breath in a way that enjoys and glorifies God, except that I do it in reliance on Jesus Christ. My job is to look up and open my mouth wide like a little bird in a nest. His job is to save, to forgive, to fill me with all that I need in order to be beautifully transformed into a new person, a person made in the image of Christ, the man after God's own heart. Let's pray together. We ask now, our Father, as we come to the table, that we would come in that very posture, come ready to receive, repenting and believing, resting and receiving, that we would be nourished at this table, and that you would use this moment to transform us more and more, that daily renewal, as we come more and more to be in the image of him who loved us and gave himself for us. It's in his name, in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Let's stand now and sing. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ and united to some congregation that teaches the gospel, it doesn't have to be this one. If you're visiting with us from another congregation where you're a regularly attending member, then we welcome you as well. As long as you are a part of the body and you see the sanctity of the church, we invite you to join us. In the life of faith, we are called to constantly and repeatedly renounce our own credentials. And we do that as an act of worship and trust. The more credentials you have, the harder it is to renounce those credentials. And when I say credentials, I mean symbols which, in the eyes of the world, prove that you're a successful or a good person. Status symbols, wins. You know, like your children grew up to go accomplish something, or you've done something successful in your career. The more credentials you have, the harder it is to renounce those credentials. And the weaker and poorer you are, the more dire your situation, the higher the rise of troubles in your life, the easier it is, frankly, to rely on God in Christ, because you have nothing else to turn to. But today, right here and right now, at this holy table, We all stand in the place of spiritual sanity. And we all acknowledge, what can you do? We can do nothing to make our broken relationship with God right. Maybe today on your way home, you'll find some homeless person who looks just deplorable and just completely weighed down with the weight of life and sin and no help. You need to look at that person and say, that person is me. When it comes to standing before God, I have the same credentials that this person has. I have nothing to commend me to God except what Jesus Christ accomplished for me. We cannot put the broken egg of our lives back in the shell. We can't. We can't, and that homeless person can't. But thanks be to God, he has done what we could never do. And now we find ourselves like little birds in a nest. We open our mouth wide to receive that grace. We now eat. We now internalize. We receive. We depend on. We digest Jesus Christ. We acknowledge in repentant faith that he is all the credentials we need. We receive Christ by faith. Let's bow and just think about that for a moment, and then we'll come forward. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Amen. Let me remind you, after the words of institution, the ushers will dismiss you and you'll come from the outside to the inside, take bread and the cup on one trip, and just take them back to your seats, and then I'll instruct us when to eat together. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." And after the meal, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Thank you.
Would you take off your mask now? This is the body of Christ shed for you. Take and eat. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and eat. Father, we thank you for the physical body of Christ being together now and receiving your body and blood, even in this unusual and almost humorous way, still reminds us that you, Lord Jesus Christ, became physical for us. And to be gathered physically draws us into that sacred mystery. We pray for those at home, those as of yet unable to join us, and we pray that you would uphold and strengthen them by your mysterious grace and bring us back to that place where once again we can gather. We pray for this nation as we face an election this coming week, and we ask for peace. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand now and sing.
See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love all mingled down.
Let's bow together and receive God's blessing. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.